the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask. May the Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that the soul of your departed servant, Bishop Paul, to whom you committed the care of your family, may, with the manifold fruits of his labors, enter into the eternal gladness of his Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Sirach. My child, when you come to serve the Lord, prepare yourself for trials. Be sincere of heart and steadfast, and do not be impetuous in times of adversity. Cling to him. Do not leave him, that you may prosper in your last days. Accept whatever happens to you. In periods of humiliation, be patient. For in fire, gold is tested, as are the chosen in the crucible of humiliation. Trust in God, and he will help you. Make your way straight and hope in him. You that fear the Lord, wait for his mercy. Do not stray, lest you fall. You that fear the Lord, trust in him, and your reward will not be lost. You that fear the Lord, hope for good things, for lasting joy, and for mercy. Consider the generations long and past and see, has anyone trusted in the Lord and been disappointed? Has anyone persevered in his fear and been forsaken? Has anyone called upon him and been ignored? For the Lord is compassionate and merciful, forgives sins, and saves in time of trouble. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
A second reading of the letter of St. James.
Who among you is wise and understanding? Let him show his works and be good life in the humility that comes from wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be so false to the truth. Wisdom of this kind does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. From where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder in every foul practice. But the wisdom from above is first of all pure, then peaceable, gentle, compliant, full of mercy and good fruits, without inconstancy or insincerity. And for the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace, and for those who cultivate peace. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
One of the criminals hanging there reviled Jesus, saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." The other, however, rebuking him, said in reply, "Have you no fear of God? For you are subject to the same condemnation. And indeed, we have been condemned justly, for the sentence we received corresponds to our crimes. But this man has done nothing criminal." Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. He replied to him, "Amen, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
On behalf of the bishops of the province of St. Paul in Minneapolis, I offer our very sincere condolences to Bishop DeGroote, to the priests and deacons and faithful of the Diocese of Sioux Falls, on the passing of your beloved Bishop Emeritus, Paul Swain. I feel so privileged to have this opportunity to preside today as directed by Bishop Swain, and with the kind permission of Bishop DeGroote, who's even allowed me to sit in his chair. You know, I always feel so comfortable here in this cathedral because it's the same architect who designed the cathedral in St. Paul. Bishop Swain, who loved this cathedral so much and had his fingers on the pulse as it was being restored so beautifully, told me that they took the best of the elements from the St. Paul Cathedral and improved upon them here. Those of you who knew Bishop Swain well, and I suspect it's most of you, won't be surprised that he left clear instructions about today's Mass. Some of the directives are in your program today as well. I encourage you to read them. They are directives that reflect a deep faith, but also a profound humility. He asked for no fanfare, the simplest and least expensive of coffins, a minute of silent prayer, which we respected in place of homiletic fireworks. What was important for Bishop Swain was that he belonged to Christ, the one who gave up his life for the forgiveness of our sins. All recognition, Bishop Swain wrote, should be given to Jesus and to the Blessed Mother. I was really taken by his reference to Mary, as he noticed that he had come to recognize her as a true mother, describing her with a convert's delight as a beautiful gift given to him later in life, and noting that she points always to Jesus. Bishop Swain seems to have adopted Mary's priority in planning this liturgy in a way that points to Jesus, the one whom he had come to know as compassionate and merciful. Divine traits stressed in this morning's first reading proclaimed so beautifully from the book of Sirach. Trust in him, Sirach writes, and our reward will not be lost. Indeed, we are reminded that no one has trusted in the Lord and been disappointed. What comforting words for us as we grieve the passing of our brother, father, and friend. Trust in the Lord is always rewarded, no matter where we are in life. The good thief in today's gospel reminds us that no one need be excluded from Christ's mercy, provided that we place our trust in him. That, brothers and sisters, is good news. Indeed, it's great news, and is the source of our confidence as we embrace the challenges placed before us in the course of our everyday life. Throughout his exceptional military service, civil service, and ministry as a priest and bishop, Bishop Swain certainly realized that those challenges exist, particularly for followers of Christ. It's significant that one of his requests was that a poem would be read at this funeral. The poem's entitled Christmas Trees and Strawberry Summers. Not exactly two ideas I would have thought about when I thought about Bishop Swain. It was written by Anne Weems and is from her anthology entitled Kneeling in Bethlehem. I'm not much of a reciter of poetry and have a somewhat raspy Pittsburgh accent, so don't listen to me. I hope that you'll be able to imagine Bishop Swain's voice in the following lines. The poem goes like this. What I'd really like is a life of Christmas trees and strawberry summers.
a walk through the zoo with a pocket full of bubblegum and a string of balloons. I'd say yes to blueberry mornings and carefree days with rainbow endings. I'd keep the world in springtime and the morning glories blooming. But life is more than birthday parties. Life is more than candied apples. I'd rather hear the singing than the weeping. I'd rather see the healing than the violence. I'd rather feel the pleasure than the pain. I'd rather know security than fear. I'd like to keep the cotton candy coming. But life is more than fingers crossed. Life is more than wishing. Christ said, "Follow me." And of course, I'd rather not. I'd rather pretend that doesn't include me. I'd rather sit by the fire and make my excuses. I'd rather look the other way, not answer the phone, and be much too busy to read the paper. But I said yes, and that means risk. It means here I am, ready or not. Oh, Christmas tree and strawberry summers, you're what I like and you are real. But so are hunger and misery and hate-filled red faces. So is confrontation, so is injustice. Discipleship means something, it means sometimes it's going to rain on my face. But when you've been blind and now you see, when you've been deaf and now you hear, when you've never understood and now you know, once you know who God calls you to be, you're not content with sitting in corners. There's got to be some alleluia shouting, some speaking out, some standing up, some caring, some sharing, some community, some risk. Discipleship means living what you know. Discipleship means thank you, Lord, for Christmas trees and strawberry summers and even for rain in my face. This morning, brothers and sisters, let's join Bishop Swain in giving thanks to the Lord who calls us to follow him. Thanking the Lord not only for Christmas trees and strawberry summers, but also for the challenges that keep us oh so very close to him. Bishop Swain was so very grateful for the vitality of this local church, of your response to the Lord's call to serve as priests or deacons, and the call to consecrated life and married life. He was so proud of your commitment to the sanctity and dignity of human life, your commitment to the Eucharist and to the family. He sang of what you were accomplishing in your schools. He boasted appropriately of his amazing presbyterate and diocesan staff. And his eyes lit up whenever he spoke about your work in restoring this amazing cathedral and your generosity in building the convent across the way for the adorers. While he would occasionally let me know of the rain he was feeling on his face, he certainly taught me the preeminent importance of gratitude in the life of a disciple, and especially in the life of a bishop. At this Eucharist, please join me in giving thanks for the many ways in which the Lord blessed us through the ministry and friendship and example of Bishop Paul Swain, the times he spoke up and stood up, the times he cared and shared, the community that he built, and the risks that he took. When the Lord said to him, "Follow me," Bishop Swain was all in and now leads us to do the same. Praise be Jesus Christ, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church, confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in the Lord Jesus. Let us join our prayers to his.
In baptism, Bishop Paul received the light of Christ. Scattered the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. We pray to the Lord. Our brother Bishop Paul was nourished at the altar of the Savior. Welcome him into the halls of the heavenly banquet. We pray to the Lord. Our brother Bishop Paul shared in the priesthood of Jesus Christ, leading God's people in prayer and worship. Bring him into your presence, where he will take his place in the heavenly liturgy. We pray to the Lord. Many friends and members of our families have gone before us and await the kingdom. Grant them an everlasting home with your Son. We pray to the Lord. Many people die by violence, war, and famine each day. Show your mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against your love, and gather them to the eternal kingdom of peace. We pray to the Lord. Those who trusted in the Lord now sleep in the Lord. Give refreshment, rest, and peace to all the departed whose faith is known to you alone. We pray to the Lord. We are assembled here in faith and confidence to pray for the happy repose of the soul of our brother, Bishop Paul. Strengthen our hope so that we may live in the joyful expectation of your Son's glorious coming. We pray to the Lord.
Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
The Lord accept the sacrifice at our hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
We humbly beseech your boundless mercy, Lord, that this sacrifice, which your departed servant and Bishop Paul, while in the body, offered to your majesty for the salvation of the faithful, may now bring him to your pardon, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me.
The mystery of faith.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Paul, and with all the saints in whose constant intercession your presence we rely for unfailing help.
May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, Donald, our Bishop, the order of bishops, the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
Remember, Lord, your servant Paul, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Cum sanctis fluvi
Let us pray. May your merciful kindness, which we have implored, O Lord, benefit the soul of your departed servant, Bishop Paul, that by these sacrificial gifts he may know the eternal company of Christ, in whom he hoped and whom he preached, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. I want to take this opportunity to thank all of you for fulfilling the wish of our brother Bishop Paul Swain. His primary wish was that we would pray for him. So I thank you, religious sisters and brothers, the deacons, the priests, all of our wonderful laity, especially those of you who tended to him so beautifully, loved him so much, and cared for him, not just at the end, but through the years. You have fulfilled what a quiet soul would desire, a very hidden, humble service, a very humble servant. Thank you, Brother Bishops, for praying for us. We're so honored to have so many of you here today, including two of our native sons, Archbishop Gullickson and Bishop Kettler, whose vocations were from this very cathedral. And for them to be here today and have parts of the Eucharistic prayer and in the liturgy, I give great thanks. I want to take this opportunity to thank you, Archbishop Hebda. It was the will of Bishop Swain that the Metropolitan Bishop would be here. Your presence fulfilled his desire. Thank you.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother, Bishop Paul. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Thank you.
Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Paul in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Bishop Paul in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
In peace, let us now take our brother to his place of rest.